Hey everybody, welcome to the back to the shop on a weekend. This is where I live and play and with all my toys, most of my toys in the background. And I don't often get really, really good questions, but sometimes I do. And I answered this one in the text box form, a comment box, but it really deserves a more in-depth approach. So anyway, let me give you the question that I got. It says 2 days ago. Seems like longer. Something I have always wondered about turbine engines is how is the engine not damaged when the fan / compressor blades are freewheeling in the wind? I like the way that he says fan / compressor. It shows that the question was asked by somebody who knows a little bit. I really like that. Okay. Freewheeling in the wind. I've been around CFM 34-8Es at work, and in high winds, the engine is spinning at what would appear to be pretty damn fast. Engine's not running, so oil pressure is low or non-existent, right? Any insight would be appreciated. So that's really cool. Now I responded saying, I'm not sure if you mean a CFM 34-8E, because I don't know what that is, or do you mean a CFM 56, or do you mean a CF 34? And then I said, doesn't really matter. They're all high bypass turbofans. And it doesn't really matter, because what we're talking about here is not a numbers and exact stuff thing, exact quantities. We're talking about a general idea, a general concept, and a lot of people like that. So anyway, got some toys here. When I said they're both high bypass turbofans. Okay, so this is the front fan, single stage, from a Rolls-Royce Spey. Actually, it's an Allison TF41, so it's a license-built copy. Very similar, not a copy, very similar. Anyway, the Spey is a roughly 1-to-1 bypass turbofan engine. And if you're wondering what a turbofan is, we'll get to that in a little second, but also I have videos called Turbojet or Turbofan. I highly recommend that you watch that or those. There's a couple of them. And no, there's not links in the description, because I do not believe in spoon feeding. And what I mean by that is, if you're not the kind of person that's going to look up turbojet versus turbofan, because I just told you to, then I can't help you. If you're going to learn and do things in this industry, or even find out stuff, you need some curiosity and a little tiny bit of resourcefulness and effort. And if it's just blasted to you right to your face like a TV dinner, it's not going to help. You're going to forget in 2 minutes. Anyway, enough of that rant. This is from a Rolls-Royce Spey, actually a TF41. They're very similar. And I'm going to show an interesting detail about this one in a second to you. This is only one blade from a CF6, which is a much larger engine. And it's about a 5-to-1 bypass ratio. So even though the core makes twice the power of a Spey, twice, it moves 5 times the air, or 10 times the air, because the bypass ratio is 1-to-1 here, and it's 5-to-1 here. So it's a much bigger fan. It's more of a turbofan than this turbofan. This one has half the air goes around the engine and half the air goes through the engine. So the exhaust stream coming out the back is mixed, and it's fairly high speed. It's quite a noisy, high speed engine, less so than a pure turbojet. This one, it has 5 times the air going around. So I guess, what would that be? It's not 80-20, it's 85% of the air goes around the engine and 15% of the air goes through the engine. So that's all mixed on the, it's not a mixed outlet, that's true. It has an annular outlet of low speed air, lots of it, like we're talking a ton per second, a ton of air per second, holy mackerel, or more. And that's an annulus, and through the center of that is a high-speed exhaust of the center core of the engine. So the low-speed gases tend to sort of cushion the high-speed gases, and it doesn't make as much noise. A pure turbojet, the size of a CF6, would be a lot like the engine in the Valkyrie, the XB70. Super duper 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 loud. Anyway, okay, turbofans. And we have a diagram of a turbofan up here. It's not the one in color, it's this one. We'll shoot a close up of that in a second. But the question we're gonna get back to is, why doesn't the engine get damaged when the thing is spinning in the wind? Well, first of all, why is it spinning in the wind? Because I've said many times, and it's true, that a fan is an enlarged stage of the compressor, and a compressor blade or a fan blade, what does it do? It moves air. It takes mechanical energy and puts it into the air and accelerates it. So it's the exact opposite of a windmill or a turbine. A turbine blade and a compressor blade have the exact opposite function. Compressor blade takes mechanical energy and puts it into the air. A turbine blade takes airstream energy and puts it into mechanical shaft energy on a turning shaft. So they're the exact opposite, but they look very similar. So the fans on a turbofan, the fan blades, are very similar to a windmill blade. Not a turbine blade, but a windmill blade. And a windmill is a type of turbine, I'm sure, but we're getting, it's difficult. I'm gonna show you exactly what I mean, so let's stop the nonsense, and we'll just take a look right now what I'm explaining to you. Hang on, here we go. Okay, what I'm talking about is, this is the front, the leading edge, and that's the trailing edge. And you can see that they're, man, it's almost the same shape. It seems like it'll work backwards and forwards. And so that's why it, when air blows through it, it makes it work like a turbine, sort of, but it's not really a turbine. Out of the same engine, this is a actual turbine blade, and it's got some scrapage on the edge. That's why it's a scrap blade. But you can see it's more like an aircraft wing. It's got a leading edge, kind of a fat section right near the front, and it trails off to the trailing edge. It's very recognizably like a wing. Okay, here we go with the CF6 fan blade. The front and the back, let's see, the front is over here. Is it? Which one? Yeah, the front is here, and the back is there, and it almost looks... Oops, where are we? Let's get this so you can see it more head on. Hang on. Okay, we're gonna try to do this. Believe it or not, the front is here, right there. It looks like the thin part. It looks like it gets thicker right there, doesn't it? And there's another sharp edge there. So it almost looks like this is the front, but I'll prove it to you. Hang on a second. Okay, so we got this is the front and that's the back. And how do we know that? We're gonna lift it up and look at the base. So the hub right there, the hub mount, it's bigger at the front than it is at the back. Generally that sort of cone-shaped inlet on a CF6 is it's right there. And this is the trailing edge of the blade and the leading edge of the blade. So interesting. So way back in the day, I think 2010, something like that, I made a video called Windmilling Turbofan, which I'm gonna show right now, if possible, some seconds of, but you should go watch Windmilling Turbofan. It's probably much less resolution than this, but I'll do what I can to splice it in there. And that actual turbofan fan, which was windmilling in our yard for many years, this blade was one of the ones in it. Okay, so the question is, does the engine get damaged by that? Basically no, but again, as with everything, it's always more complicated than what you think, because there is no answer. Because really, if you're gonna store, let's say a 747, you're gonna store a 747 for 6 months. I don't know why you're gonna do that, but you are. Well, what you do is you put those big covers on the front of the engine and the back of the engine to keep birds, dust, dirt, wind, UAVs out of the engine. And by having those covers there, there's going to be no airflow, and the thing's not going to turn. So if it's going to be stored overnight, you make a judgment call whether or not you're going to put those covers on. Maybe where it is, maybe where it's parked, there aren't those covers. I don't know. Those things are, I don't know how many there are. I don't know how expensive they are. I don't know if there's enough covers for all the airplanes all the time. But if your aircraft is going to be parked overnight and not be used for 8 hours, 6 hours, whatever, you could put the covers in, or maybe you chose not to. If you choose not to, we did some calculations in the answer that let's go with the CF6. It's roughly a 50,000 horsepower, roughly. The actual core of a CF6 becomes an LM2500, and they go up to 60, anywhere from 25 to 60,000 horsepower as industrial engines. It all depends on which version you have and the aerodynamics and the cooling and all that kind of stuff, but basically 25 to 60,000 horsepower. And that's at moving at, I think the fan speed is 3,600 RPM or 3,400 on the CF6. And so how fast is it moving when the wind is blowing on a stormy night in Cincinnati or anywhere? And you've got rain going in there, and rain and snow and wind, and it's spinning around. It's just looking at it, just guessing. The one that we had in our yard was turning, 50 RPM, maybe 100 at your wildest dream. In a storm, it might hit 100. Let's say 200 RPM. So 200 RPM out of 3,400, what's that, 1/17? It's a little bit, about 5%. Keeping in mind that the power generated by the fan, or the power absorbed by the turbine, it is exponential. Like, when we test these engines, they make no power up to about 85% RPM. Excuse me. And that's max of maximum RPM. So at 90% RPM, you're just kind of getting into the useful range for an airliner. And it makes full power, 50,000 horsepower, at 100% RPM. It doesn't always run at that RPM, but it's designed, the bearing that supports this fan is designed to, well, that one is designed to handle 20,000 horsepower, 50,000 of the CF6. And so that fan, the amount of force that it transmits at that high speed, everything is flexible, even steel is compressible. So the bearings against the steel race have a microscopic, super tiny microscopic flexibility or compression, and running like that, it heats up. So it heats up, and the heat is carried away by the oil circulation. The oil to the front fan of a CF6 is probably, to the front fan support bearing, the front fan thrust bearing, is probably a couple gallons a minute, 10, 20 liters a minute. And it's there to, what are the five functions of oil? Pop quiz. Okay, they are oil, it prevents corrosion, it lubricates, it cleans, it cools, and it transmits power. Not all in that order. The order of those things depends upon what it's doing. But in the fan bearing of a large turbofan, it, number one, it's a coolant. Number two, it's a cleaner. It carries away any microscopic amounts of debris that is generated by the wear and tear, which hopefully is next to nothing, hopefully, from the bearing. Three, it lubricates. It doesn't need to lubricate any sliding surfaces because it's all rolling, but it's a lubricant. Four, where are we at now? It transmits power. It doesn't really transmit power in the turbofan thrust bearing, so that's way at the back. And what was the fourth one? It prevents corrosion. So corrosion prevention and power transmission, they're way at the back. You got your lubrication, far back there. Cleaning. Cleaning is still quite far at the back of the pack. And number one with a bullet is coolant. It's a coolant. It's taking that heat away from that bearing so it stays within its happy zone and it runs fantastically for thousands and thousands of hours with no problems. So, you got a 50,000 horsepower bearing transmitting 50,000 pounds of thrust. So the bearing is loaded with 25 tons and it's spinning at 3,500 RPM. So it's working. Now, in the wind, it's turning, 5% of that RPM? And it takes how much force to make this turn, even this fan turn, to make it turn at 100 RPM? If you were supporting that bearing and the wind was wafting through and it was turning at 100 RPM, let's be really generous and say it's 100 pounds of force. 100 pounds of force generated by the wind pushing on that fan to make it turn. And interestingly enough, if the fan is being turned by the wind, it's going the same way, it's turning the same direction as if it is pushing the air backwards. The air is going through it this way, whether it's pushing the blade to turn or the blade is pushing the air, it's the same. So if the blade goes too fast, if the turbofan starts going too fast, it reduces the pushing of the wind. It wouldn't do that, but it's an interesting thought experiment. Anyway, so 100 pounds of force at 5% of the RPM, keeping in mind that the force generated by the fan is exponential, we've got far less than 1% of the workload on the bearing. And the bearing is a huge, it's a ball bearing that's about this big. I don't have one here with me, unfortunately. It's a big ball bearing. The whole thing weighs about, 75 pounds. And it's mounted inside a metal casing that the case, I believe the case is stainless steel. And the shaft in the center of the bearing that is turning on the bearing is a huge 1,000-pound steel forging. So that's a lot of metal with wind blowing through it. And so any heat generated by that bearing is going to be like a couple of bumblebees huddled up in the cold. It's nothing. So that whatever heat is generated by the windmilling of the turbofan engine in the wind when it's parked, even in warm air, is easily going to be dissipated through the metal frame of the front frame and the engine and the giant metal shaft that the fan is attached to. Never mind the fact that the fan is a giant heat sink as well. So we're working at such low power levels. It's almost like the when you open the hood of your car and a light bulb comes on. If you close the hood and if the light bulb stayed on, would that overheat the engine? No. Technically, it's a source of heat, and it's just not enough to make anything happen. So, the reason that you'd want to put the covers on there is because the engine oil is, there's only a little bit in there. And I guess if you let it run on an intact serviceable engine, if you let it windmill for 10 years, I still think it would be okay, because there's something else that we mentioned, is the oil pumps. Oh, we're going to get to that in a second. Let's do that right now. Hang on. Okay, I apologize that it's not a color diagram. If you want a fantastic color diagram of a turbofan engine, you want to get the book called The Jet Engine by Rolls-Royce. It's available online as a free download in various places. Anyway, this is the fan of an RB211, which is a three-spool engine, which makes it a bit more complicated, but we're going to survive through that just fine. The fan has its own turbine, and what we're going to do is we're going to pretend it's not. We're going to pretend it's a CF6, and so the fan and the low-pressure compressor and the CF6 turns at the same speed. On the RB211, the fan turns slower than this part, but we're going to imagine this is a CF6, and so all of this right to there turns at the same speed. That's the low-pressure compressor, including the fan, which is what mostly, it's the only thing you see windmilling, the thing we're talking about. Now, it's connected to nothing. There's a speed pickup, probably says somewhere. Up here, there's gonna be a little thing in the frame. It's a magnetic pickup that senses the speed of rotation of the fan. That's the only thing mechanically connected or mechanically driven to this shaft. It's not even mechanical, it's a magnetic non-contact speed pickup. So this can turn very easily, no load on it whatsoever. Now, from here, we've got the low pressure or the high pressure compressor, and it's got a single stage turbine. Right from here, this part here, I know it's hard to see, I apologize. This part here is a separate shaft. It's got a big hole down the middle, so it's a big hollow shaft, and it turns at its own speed, and through the middle of it, the low pressure system turns. Okay? So the HP system, the high pressure system, turns at its own speed, but it has the combustion of fuel that drives the turbine that makes the compressor go. It is like an engine all by itself. And so that's why this is often called the core, the fuel burning core. This would run by itself. And what this is, the LP system, is essentially a giant 50,000 horsepower turbocharger for this thing. So this is turning at, in the CF6, 4,000 RPM-ish. And this is turning at 9,500, 9,200, something like that. So anyway, the engine itself, not the turbocharger, but the engine is what drives all this stuff. And you can see there's a what they call a transfer gearbox here. The transfer gearbox is, there's a ring gear on the outside of the shaft, the HP shaft. It runs a bevel drive down to here to an intermediate gearbox. And then this is the, I don't know what this is called, but this is the, that gearbox, that drive, that's an angle drive. This is the accessory gearbox. And guess what the accessory gearbox has? So the accessory gearbox is what we're actually dealing with right now with the Arenda build on the Patreon channel. It's a sort of a different type of videos. They are basically like you're with me in the shop doing everything to rebuild an entire engine, which takes over a year. It's a lot of videos. They're often close to an hour or over an hour long. Anyway, I recommend you check it out if you want that kind of thing. But the accessory gearbox has attached to it the it's got a speed pickup to tell you the RPM of the core. It's got the oil pumps because the fuel burning part of the engine is, it's the engine. So it runs the oil pumps. It also runs the fuel pumps and electrical generators. Anything else that is needed by the aircraft or the engine is powered by the fuel-burning core, which, like I said, it's like an engine, and then the LP system wrapped around it is basically like a gigantic turbocharger. So, yeah. So what I'm trying to say is the fan itself is freewheeling, and the fan bearing, if the fan was only turning, and it most likely is because you can see how big the fan is and how small everything else is, the fan is probably the only thing turning. So the bearing's getting no oil. But again, it's very clean in there. It's a super high precision bearing, and it's generating heat. It's most likely not generating particles of metal and bits and stuff because it's under insignificant load. But over years or decades, I think that oil could use a little help. It could be replaced. So in that case, you would want to make sure the fan is not freewheeling for 10 years or 5 years or 1 year. You might get away with 1 year, but still, if you're a responsible airline and you've stored it for a year, windmilling in the wind, I think you should probably have a look at the bearing. I really do. Anyway, there's a possibility that the wind going through it might turn the HP system, unlikely because it's driving all those accessories, but it's a big thing when there's a lot of wind blowing through there. If the HP system does turn even a little bit, well, the oil pumps, they're positive displacement. So even if it's meant to turn at 9,000 RPM, and if it's going this fast, you know, like 10 RPM, it's turning the oil pumps, and those oil pumps are working very slowly. They're not like a centrifugal blower. They're like a piston or a gear pump. They have their positive displacement, and no matter how slowly they turn, they're pushing oil. And if you're supposed to be getting, say, 20 liters a minute of oil to this bearing, and you're getting one drop every 5 minutes, that's enough. I think the oil that's in there is fine, and any amount of flow whatsoever is just going to benefit it. Now, I've taken apart scrap engines, and so long as water hasn't been able to drip in, water has not got in there, the bearing races and the bearing housings and the bearings themselves in all of these separate bearings in the engine, they look perfect after 20 years. Now, they haven't been turning, they've just been sitting there. But the oil does very much act as a anti-corrosive agent when it's not doing anything else. So that's a long way of saying that it is more complicated than you think, because it's got a lot more factors. But in general, depending on how long they're stored, a windmilling turbofan will not be damaged by windmilling in the wind. It's going too slow. It's not doing it long enough. The oil's got you covered for overnight for sure, maybe for 6 months or so, 6 months to a year. And but it's a very interesting question, because it's you would think that it would cause wear and tear. I think the engine would only be damaged by windmilling if it was done for extreme lengths of time, and even then, it would just warrant an inspection of the bearing, and it's probably going to be fine. So it was a very interesting question. It caused a bit of discussion. If you have any questions, or if you, like a few of the people out there, think that I have no idea what I'm talking about, feel free to add in the comments. Add your comments in the comments. We always like to hear them. And yeah, on a weekend at the end of summer. Thanks for watching.